This boy let the wolf bite his arm. When his uncle saw this, he rushed out with a gun to save him. But the boy yells at his uncle to put the gun away, because he was just playing with the wolf. Then they ran up the hill together. The wolf was running fast. It disappeared into the trees. While the boy was looking for it, a brown bear suddenly stood up. The boy ran away. He went over the hill. A pile of wood appeared in front of him. The boy dug into it. The bear's head was too big for it, so he stood up and put his hand in the log and scratched the boy's arm. The wolf realized the boy was in danger and came out. It attracts the bear's attention, but the wolf bared his teeth. He's not afraid of the bear, which is bigger than he is, and the bear is intimidated by him, turned away and gave up the chase. The boy climbed safely out of the stake and found the wolf standing by the river, so he took out a piece of jerky to thank him. Not long before Jack was set to leave this place to seek his fortune elsewhere, he found White Fang standing alone by the riverbank, gazing solemnly into the distance. As a gesture of gratitude for White Fang saving his life, Jack left a piece of jerky for him, saying, "I won't forget you." Yet White Fang barely reacted, turning his head away with an air of indifference. Dejected, Jack boarded his boat and departed. Halfway through the journey, he looked up and was startled to see White Fang climbing to a higher vantage point to watch him leave. In that moment, White Fang felt a deep, inexplicable bond with Jack. Beyond his mother, no one had ever cared for him with such genuine affection. After Jack left, White Fang's life returned to its usual routine. One day, the chief tasked White Fang with pulling a sled loaded with furs into town for sale. Upon arrival, White Fang obediently lay outside the building, waiting. During this time, three thugs, accompanied by a vicious dog, came along and decided to provoke a confrontation. Seeing White Fang alone, they unleashed their dog, which charged at him. Contrary to the thugs' expectations, the seemingly subdued White Fang took only 3 seconds to thoroughly thrash the attacking dog, which attempted to flee but was caught by the tail. Just as White Fang was getting serious, the vicious dog surrendered, rolling over to expose its belly in defeat. The leader of the thugs, far from being upset, was actually thrilled by White Fang's prowess and declared his intent to own such a formidable wolf. The thugs approached White Fang, brandishing sticks, but the chief, hearing the commotion, arrived just in time. He calmed White Fang with a gesture and then hurriedly apologized to the thugs. Furthermore, the chief offered a prime piece of fur in hopes of appeasing them. However, the thug leader was not satisfied. He threatened the chief, saying, "An Indian walking a wolf through town without a leash? Today, you either leave the wolf or go to jail." Faced with the arrogant and domineering colonizers, the chief, despite his reluctance, felt he had no choice but to agree. Soon after being taken by the thugs, White Fang found himself thrust into a dogfighting ring. The noisy crowd surrounding the pit made him incredibly anxious, but he had no way out as his opponent charged at him. White Fang was reluctant to engage in combat with another of his kind, consistently dodging and retreating, but the aggressive black dog relentlessly pushed him into a corner. In a desperate act of self-defense, White Fang instinctively struck back, critically injuring the black dog with a single bite. Stunned by his own actions, White Fang looked down at the black dog lying defeated and felt a deep sense of guilt. The thug leader, however, was indifferent to White Fang's turmoil. He had just won a significant amount of money and was ecstatic. His minions dragged White Fang away, preparing him for the next fight. From then on, White Fang became a money-making tool for the thugs. To avoid beatings, he numbly stepped into the pit time and again, struggling to survive in brutal bouts that made his owner rich. Despite his unmatched prowess, White Fang never received the treatment a champion deserved. He was confined daily to a narrow cage, and the thug leader would often torment him with cruel methods to foster his ferocity. Each night, White Fang would curl up quietly on the ground, a part of him forever altered by the harsh realities of his existence. On that day, the thug leader arranged another match for White Fang, this time against a small yet fierce fighting dog. Despite its diminutive size, this dog was vicious and nearly killed White Fang. The battle commenced with the fighting dog aggressively launching attacks. But White Fang, calm and collected, used his size advantage to easily deflect the assaults. White Fang never anticipated that this opponent was unlike any he had faced before, trained specifically to be a killer among its kind. Just when White Fang thought the dog would concede, it seized an unguarded moment to clamp down viciously on his neck, refusing to let go. Within seconds, White Fang was pinned to the ground, gasping for breath. Enraged and frustrated, the thug leader jumped into the pit and started brutally beating White Fang with a cane, berating him as useless. At that critical moment, the thug was suddenly pulled down. Before he could react, a gun was pressed against his chest. A group of people stormed the arena, one of them using an iron rod to pry the fighting dog's jaws open. The leader of the group, a young man, without a moment's hesitation, lifted White Fang and carried him out of the pit. Back at the hotel, the young man tenderly dressed White Fang's wounds, saving his life. It was only then that White Fang realized the young man was none other than Jack, whom he had not seen for years. White Fang looked at Jack, but there was no joy in his eyes, only a reflection of the deep scars within. Jack, noticing the profound change in White Fang, sat worriedly, unable to fathom what horrors White Fang had endured over the years. The following day, Jack and his companions constructed a simple stretcher to transport White Fang to a mining area in the outskirts, where the environment was conducive to his recovery. Despite the serene surroundings, White Fang appeared ungrateful. He ignored the food Jack offered and withdrew his leg, growling threateningly when Jack touched him. After some time, White Fang physically recovered, but his psychological wounds remained raw. His experiences with humans, who had treated him merely as a tool, devoid of any genuine connection, had left him deeply scarred. Now, White Fang trusted no one, not even Jack. White Fang even considered escaping, but his chain was tangled around a chair. As Jack approached to help him, White Fang crouched low, ready to attack, hesitant, but believing that White Fang would not harm him. Jack resisted his fear and slowly extended his hand. Unexpectedly, White Fang bit him, causing blood to spurt from the wound. Jack quickly pressed against the injury to stem the bleeding, enduring the pain and softly telling White Fang, "It's okay, I know you didn't mean it." White Fang locked eyes with Jack, his gaze filled with hatred and fear. He remained on high alert, never relaxing his guard, even as Jack backed out of the room, leaving White Fang alone with his turmoil. Despite the setbacks, Jack never lost hope. Each time he tried to approach White Fang, the wolf would keep his distance. But Jack remained convinced that this was not White Fang's true nature. He believed that someday, his sincerity would heal the emotional wounds White Fang had suffered. Over time, and through persistent effort, White Fang began to lower his guard around Jack, taking a risk of being bitten again. Jack held a piece of jerky in his palm. Although tense, White Fang did not resist this time. As he ate the jerky, he allowed Jack to gently stroke his forehead with his other hand. Feeling the warmth from Jack's touch, White Fang finally relaxed his defenses. This was the first time he felt genuine warmth from a human, and the first time he showed affection towards one voluntarily. Sometimes, White Fang would accompany Jack into the mine to help transport soil. With White Fang's help, their gold mining efforts became much more efficient. One day, as usual, White Fang followed Jack into the mine. Suddenly, Jack's companions outside sensed something was wrong. Just as one turned his head, the mine collapsed in a cloud of dust and debris. Panicked, they rushed to rescue Jack, but found the passage blocked by earth. White Fang frantically dug through the dirt, and with the help of Jack's companions, who set aside their mining lamps to assist, they quickly opened a small tunnel through which they found Jack, who had narrowly escaped death. Exhausted, Jack sat at the tunnel entrance, with White Fang anxiously guarding him, fearful of any further danger. When Jack noticed the dirt on White Fang's paws, his initial shock turned into joy. He and his companions ventured back into the mine and discovered that the deepest part of the stone wall was studded with twinkling gold. It turned out that in the process of rescuing Jack, White Fang had inadvertently uncovered gold hidden within the rock wall. Soon, all the gold was excavated. Lightly stroking White Fang, Jack expressed his deep gratitude for the wolf's crucial help. However, joy soon turned to sorrow. While Jack and White Fang were in town selling the gold, White Fang furrowed his brow, sensing danger. The next morning, while Jack and his companions were sleeping, a torch was suddenly thrown through the window, and soon a fierce fire engulfed the outside of the house. The thug leader, bearing a grudge, lay in ambush, intent on making Jack and White Fang pay. As thick smoke began to fill the room, the thugs rushed forward. The leader, a burly man with a large beard, kicked open the door, only to be surprised as White Fang, fearless of the flames, charged out and knocked him to the ground, leaving him dazed. The leader panicked, firing his gun only to hit the empty air. Seeing his enemy, rage ignited in White Fang's eyes. He sprinted, crossing a small creek and catching the leader off guard with a powerful kick. As old grudges came to the fore, White Fang launched a furious attack, biting into the leader's buttocks with vengeance. The leader struggled, but White Fang clamped down on his arm relentlessly. Thanks to White Fang's heroic resistance, the gang was quickly subdued by Jack and his companions and handed over to the police. Soon after, Jack planned to leave for New York to pursue further opportunities. His companions reminded him that they could not take a wolf back to the city. Jack remained silent, while White Fang seemed to sense the impending farewell. resting his head gently on Jack's lap, his eyes filled with trust and affection. In the evening, Jack took White Fang to the riverside. The scenery was picturesque, but all they could see was each other. After what felt like an eternity, Jack finally mustered the courage to take White Fang out of the forest to the open wilderness. He unfastened White Fang's leash and gently advised, "Take care of yourself!" With a deep kiss on White Fang's forehead, Jack stood up, waved his hand, and encouraged White Fang to return to nature. But as Jack turned to leave, White Fang quickly followed. Frustrated and flushed, Jack tried to shoo him away, but no matter what he said or how he scolded, White Fang stood firm, unwilling to depart. It was only when Jack picked up a stick and threatened to hit him that White Fang, frightened, turned and fled, dropping the stick. Jack felt a profound sense of loss. He started to run, as if trying to outrun the grief of their parting. 3 days later, Jack arrived at the dock, ready to board the ship and set sail. But just as he was about to step onto the boat, he suddenly stopped. Turning to his companion, he said, "I can't go now." His companion gave a knowing smile, expressing understanding. As soon as he spoke these words, Jack felt a tremendous weight lift from his shoulders. Smiling, he bid farewell to his companion and turned back along the path he had come. Returning to the mining area, Jack planned to repair the burnt-down cabin. Suddenly, feeling a presence, he looked up and there was White Fang, standing not far away, looking at him with joy.